So today I'm pleased to introduce our next speaker, who is Professor Benoit Ladoux. He's Research Director of the CNRS, which is the French National Center for Scientific Research, at the Institut Jacques Monod of the University Paris Diderot. His research focuses on the study of cell behavior, tissue mechanics, and the interaction of living organisms with their environments. More specifically, Professor Benoit Ladoux is interested in the cooperation of adhesion-associated mechanotransduction along with biomechanical and biochemical signaling in the adaptation of living cells to changes in their environments. He's also expert on the fabrication of micro and nano tools to measure those signals in the environment. And today he's going to talk about active nematics behaviors of cellular monolayers.
Okay, so by, so now you can hear me, right? So
yeah, we can see.
Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation and for the unfortunately we cannot do it in live, I would say, but so we will do it through Zoom, but so it's slightly more complicated than being there and having a real meeting. So indeed, I mean, I think it's important if you have any question. I mean, maybe do not wait at the end of the talk, especially if it's like very specific question, but you can interrupt me whenever you want, especially if you want to me to precise things or to be a bit more a bit clearer on a few points, especially from biology, because I realize that I mean, most of your background is not super strong in biology. So if you have any question about the terminology that I'm using and so on and so forth, I mean, do not really hesitate to interrupt me. So indeed, I will today I will talk about this idea of active behaviors of collective systems in biology, and especially cellular monolayers. To basically mimic some processes that either occur in vivo or to give some experiment in vitro, I would say, in vitro meaning that not in animal models, to potentially get some I mean, new ideas or new perspectives to the what's may happen in vivo in terms of, I mean, the work that we are doing may have an impact on morphogenesis, basically, so very fundamental biology, but also in more like, for instance, you will see at the end on this idea of potentially tumor progressions or cancer invasion and so on. So this work has been, so for a while I was sharing my time between Singapore, this Mechanobiology Institute, and Paris. So now I'm fully in Paris. And so I would like just to mention that indeed the beginning of this work started in Singapore. So that's why I put both affiliation on the first slide. So what you can see on this first slide is this like color map of, so what you have is a monolayer of cells. So each colored dot is a single cell, and so you have multiple cells that can interact with each other. And I think that you can, at least on this picture, you can appreciate that those cells, they have some kind of elongated behavior. That's why the focus of the talk today will be on this active behavior of cells, but also really well focused on this active nematic behavior, and I will come back to this idea of active nematics. All right, so just for so I will start to give a very broad introduction in the physics of the system and in the biology. The idea behind all the system that we are studying here is the fact that we are dealing with active matter. So you may have active matter in purely physics system, but in biology it's per se active matter, because they are all, I mean, if you think of polymers inside the cell, like the cytoskeleton, for those of you who knows what are the cytoskeleton, or if you think of, I mean, movement of animals and so on, all those kind of systems are usually dealing with a large number of agents, and all the systems are non-equilibrium systems. Okay, so you always have energy, which is basically consumed at the molecular scale. So the consumption of ATPs, this idea of hydrolysis of ATP, and this kind of chemical energy leads to various type of motion at the at multiple length scale that could be at the length scale of a few of the intracellular system inside a single cell, but that could be also the what's happening during the formation of multicellular system, and I will give you a few examples of that, even in the formation of or in the collective motion of birds or fishes and so on and so forth. So that's quite an important point here, and that's what I mean. That's why I think the physics behind is quite interesting, because indeed you have system that can lead to some behavior that you cannot usually understand with, I mean, in passive system. Okay, so this idea of having active systems is quite important. Meaning that, for instance, if you think of this active system, they can react actively to the force that you exert on the system. They can change their shape and so on and so forth. And I will give you a few examples showing that indeed you can, with this kind of system, people are now defining like turbulence at even though you are at low Reynolds number. So they define this what they call active turbulence. So you have all this kind of analogy and a few concepts in physics that can be actually reanalyzed in this kind of biological system, even though at first sight we may say, okay, we are at low Reynolds numbers, so there should not be any turbulence, but still we can define something which is active turbulence. We can and I will show you that indeed in this field of active matter, of active nematic matter, there are some important, I mean, that the active stresses or the active forces that play a major role in the system to define the organism or to help to understand how cells can move together. So just to go back to this idea of active matter, I give you here a few examples at different length scale just to show you this collective movement. So here you have. On this movie on the left, you have the motion of microtubules which are moving on the bed of kinesin. As you can observe, you have this kind of like first and you have a lot of motion. Okay, so you can observe that you have some singularities that emerge in the system. I will come back to this idea of these singularities, like misalignment basically of this kind of like long filament. And you have some domains where those filaments, as you can see, are quite well aligned. Okay, so you have this kind of you may have differences, and but still the system is moving, and the system is moving because you have this energy consumption again for the which is due to the motion of this microtubule system on which are plated on a bed of kinesin motors in that case. So the system is an active system. Out of equilibrium system. The other system that I would like to show you here, so you can make a guess of how those cells will behave on this micro pattern disc. So here you have single cell, okay, so it's in one cell, another one, and so on. So you have an epithelial layer which is on this micro pattern system where they cannot spread out of this circle, so they stay in this circle because of the chemistry of the system. And as you can observe, spontaneously, the system is rotating, so it can rotate clockwise or anti-clockwise, but the system is rotating, and we are trying to understand why the system is rotating and so on. But what I want to show you here is that you may have this kind of like spontaneous coordination and spontaneous rotation of cells, even though at first they are not connected, so you need this kind of connection, and the fact that you may have like large scale coordination over a given length scale, which is again due to the fact that you have some active properties in the system. So I will not insist too much on this the flocks of these birds, for instance, that you have, but that move also collectively, or this idea of the schools of fishes, which are like moving in circles to avoid the being eaten by a predator. All right, but meaning that at this different length scale, you have this collective movement. Okay, so I will mostly talk about collective movement today. You have this collective movement that are quite rich in terms of physics and in terms of behavior, and you can see from those different examples, I hope that you may have, I mean, you have surprising behavior, basically, something that you will not expect again with purely passive systems. The other example that I would like to say from the biology is this, the development of the embryo of the zebrafish from the stage of two cells until almost the final shape of the embryo, as you can see at the end of the movie, that will give this blue fish on the right. What you observe is that you have a lot of movement, and all those movements are driven by cell shape changes, by the fact that cells are moving, they are migrating, they are dividing, and so on and so forth. And all this movement, indeed, that needs some coordination in terms of division, in terms of migration. They need some coordination, and they also, again, need some kind of activity to be able to maintain and lead to this final shape. So here it's clear that you have again this kind of active behavior that have an impact on the shape of the cell, on their migration rate as a collective system, again, because here you will see at some point that you have this thin layer of cells that will invade completely the surface here of the embryo. As you will see, they divide at first, and then you will have this kind of thin layer that is forming and that moving to the back. And as it moving to the back, you have this kind of like collective movement of those dividing cells, which are going to form the first shape of the embryo. Okay, so now if I just to go a little bit further into the molecular mechanism of those active materials, the way you can see this biological system is the fact that they are also physical objects. Again, I will not insist on the fact that they are active matter, but inside those cells, their activity basically, or the forces that are generated, are usually, I mean, it's not only this, but an important component of the fourth generation is this actin cytoskeleton, and the fact that you have inside either single cell or inside monolayers of cells, internally in the intracellular compartment, you have filament which are connected to this like green filament here, which are myosin motors. And this filament in red, which are actin filaments, they are moving along these myosin motors, and the myosin motors are moving on the actin filament. And you see that you have some bipolar organization of this myosin motor, meaning that they are moving in opposite direction on the actin filament, helping the filament to contract. So that's how you can generate forces inside the cytoskeleton by having this interaction between the myosin head that is interacting with the actin filament and the actin filament. So like that, you have contraction. Those contraction can be seen as the formation of bundles of those actin polymers. Bundles by not only by myosin, but there are other factors, but they are also bundles by myosin motors, and that can generate forces inside the cell. And usually, if you look at the system as a single cell, that would be important for one part of my talk. What you can do is to measure the force that the cells can exert on a substrate. If you are doing some in vitro models, for instance, in vitro models meaning that you are culturing cells on like on external surfaces like glass, plastic, or even this kind of like flexible gel, where you can measure the force because those gels can be deformed. That's why we are using that. You put beads inside, okay, inside the gel, and by looking at the deformation of the beads, you can measure the force that the cells can exert. And most and what you the I mean, one of the important picture of this force, to make it simple, is the fact that you have usually this idea of a force dipole, meaning that you have two poles at the two sides of the living cell, which are exerting opposite forces. Okay, so even if the system is moving, I mean, it's not super clear on this cell here, but these cells can move forward. For instance, you may have some symmetry breaking processes inside that leads to the formation of a leading edge and a trailing edge. Even if the cell is moving, considering the velocity at which those cells are moving, you can and the calculation of the force that they exert on the substrate, the overall forces that the cell is exerting is around zero. So if you sum up the vectorial force underneath the cells, it's almost zero. Okay, the friction force is super low because the velocity of the cell is low, and so you end up with this diagram here where you have this kind of force dipole with force which are balanced between the ones on one side and the other side. Okay, so that's usually a nice representation, or that's at least a representation that physicists are using to model the mechanics of a single cell by having this kind of contractile fiber between the two poles, and this contractile fiber is exerting a force inside the cell. So this is for a single cell, but now if you think of a monolayers, it's not only the force which are exerted at the interface with the substrate which is underneath, but you have also forces which are exerted at the cell-cell junction. Meaning that in a monolayer of cells, you have cells which are making a junction or connection with each other through some kind of transmembranaire proteins, like cadherins, for those of you who know the system. And those systems here are forming like homophilic interactions. So you have these extracellular domains of the cadherin, which are connected to the extracellular domains of the other cadherins at the cell-cell interface, making a connection between one cell and the other, and helping and intracellularly a connection with the cytoskeleton, which is again pulling on the system. So you have forces at the interface with the substrate, but you have also stresses which are transmitted through the cell-cell junction to maintain, for instance, the cohesion of the system. So they are quite important, and the strengths of those adhesion points are important again to either to for the plasticity of the contact, or for the coordinated movement that you can observe. So here you have one example where you see in live the formation of a contact between two cells. So this is the E-cadherin, which is labeled on this movie here. And you see that when the cells are entering into contact here, they are starting to form a cell-cell adhesion contact, which is quite small, and that can extend over time. So this adhesion is extending over time as you are forming the cell-cell contact between these two cells. Okay? So that's exactly the example that I want to show here. And so which means that in that case, when you start to form this kind of like cell doublet, you have a part of the force which will be transmitted to the other cells instead of being transmitted to the substrate. So you have always this idea of a crosstalk in this system between the forces exerted at the cell-cell surface, as it is represented here, and the forces exerted at the cell-cell junction. Okay? And this and how this crosstalk is regulated, it's still, I mean, to my opinion at least, an open question and an important question. Okay, so if you think now of the physics of the material, so this you may know, so I will not insist too much about that, but I'm taking this from the review from Dave White. Which is called, I think it was published in PNAS, and they were having this the cell as a material, and basically what you have usually to describe the passive rheology or the passive mechanical properties of the cell is a viscoelastic system. So usually it's well described by a Maxwell model, where you have a system which is elastic at short time scale and which flows at long time scale, so that can be viscous at long time scale, which defines some kind of viscoelastic time scale, which is usually so it's again, it's a very simplistic way of seeing it, but which is defined by the ratio between the viscosity and the elasticity. Again, it's could be. I mean, there would be some. I mean, I will not enter into that because I don't really need it today. But if you're interested in that, there are a lot of literature published by Fred Berg, Trepa, and so on. I mean, a lot of people on this kind of rheology of either on the cytoskeleton or cells, leading to like power law responses of rheology. So they are like again multiple time scale. It's not only one, but at least. At first sight, we can imagine that the system can react like that, meaning that you may have again an elastic or a viscous response. I mean that's important to keep that in mind. And these active properties, again, as I was mentioning before, they are coming from the fact that you have inside the cell you have a physical gel like this actin myosin. Interaction I was mentioning before. So you have the myosin motors in blue here, the actin filament in red here. This is coming from a review by Jacques Pro, Julie Cher and Joigny. And what you have here is that you have a physical gel because it's like you have some finite lifetime of the bond between those connection between the different polymers. And the system again is out of equilibrium, and you can define based on the chemical potential of this ATP hydrolysis, which is driven the interaction between the myosin and the actin and the traction forces, you can define, and I will come back to that, an active stress in the system, which has an origin at this microscopic level again, and that will lead to these cell shape changes, to the fact that you have like cells that can move and have some this kind of coordinating motion and so on and so forth. So the energy and the activity is coming from this reaction. All right. So now, if you think of, I will enter into this idea of single cell and nematic and polarity. If you think of a single cell, as I was mentioning before, you can have a cells which have a polarity. So you see that this single cell, for instance, which is moving over the substrate, it has a strong lamellipodia on one side. So here you have the front edge of the cell, and you have the back side of the cell. You can see this retraction fiber at the back. The cell is detaching at the back, is making new adhesion at the front, and that's how you can translocate the cell body. Okay? And here you have a clear polarity, so you have a polar object. Okay, this polar object can be defined because you have a head, you have a tail, and so you can define a polar particles. In other situation, you can imagine that you have this kind of cells which are elongated, roughly elongated similarly in both direction, and you may have a particle which is elongated but which is apolar. Okay. So you have this kind of apolar particle, and this kind of apolar particle, if you put them together, you may have you may have some kind of nematic order of either apolar particle. This is example on the right, or you may even have nematic order of polar particles if the polar order is not so very important at the collective level. Okay. So the one of the question is since you have this. You may have situations where cells have some polarity. You have other situations where cells have less polarity, meaning that they stay in place and they may have a polarity, but which is defined over a very short time scale, meaning that they can probably extend a small lamellipodia on one side. Okay, this retract quickly, this lamellipodia, extend on the other side, and so on and so forth. So if you average a little bit that over time, you can still say that this is an apolar particle. But again, it depends a lot on the time scale that you have in the system. All right, so which means that if you think now of so these single cells, they can behave as again as apolar particles and so on. But if you think of a monolayer, so this is only a schematic, but a lot of what is what you can see in this schematic is coming from real experiment. And what you may have in this system is that you have like various behavior. Okay, so you can have like a cluster of cells that can move together with some kind of polarity, a global polarity of the cluster. So meaning that all cells can be even at the single cell level polarized in the same direction and can help this cluster to move within the colony. you may have more like the movement that I was showing you before, this kind of like swirling motion that you can also observe in the global monolayers. And you have also like the emergence of polarity at the front of, for instance, if you think of a wound healing model, you may have a polarity at the front of the monolayer, which can be due to the fact that you can form, I will not enter into this detail, but that you can form leader cell at the front, so cells basically which are can pull on the followers and lead to this kind of polarity event. So you have and other events like this kind of organization, and I will mention that later. So basically, you have interaction between these different components. You have cell-cell interaction that leads to this idea of having a large-scale polarity. You may have coordination. You can measure correlation lengths in the system, and this kind of measurement show you that you have indeed length scales of interaction which are larger than the size of the individual component. Okay, so it really means that the coupling at the cell-cell interface is super important to understand the dynamics of these cellular monolayers. So I will be very brief, just in case you are interested in that, and just to show you that we can indeed have different various dynamics depending on the system that we are using. I just want to show you something that we did recently, that was to use some confined environment where you have those cells which are inside a confined system, which have been done by microfabrication. So you can micro pattern like those rings on the substrate, and you can like that you can really control the geometry, and you can control the places where you want to have those cells. So here you see the scale bar is 200 micrometer, you have the time scale, and one cell is a very small unit inside here. Okay, so one cell is around 10 micrometer. And what you can observe in this system is that spontaneously you form this coordinated rotation. So those cells are starting to rotate all together. And we understood this mechanism. So again, I will be very brief because I want to talk mostly about the second part. But it's just to give you an example that the polarity can be important. We understand this movement by the fact that each cell is individually polarized inside the systems, as you can see here from these markers. You can at least see that there is a gradient of intensity, so the cells are rotating clockwise in that case, and you have a gradient of intensity in each individual cells, and this gradient of intensity tells you that there is a polarity marker, because it's one of the proteins which is important for the branching of the actin filament at the tip of the lamellipodia. So basically what you have here is the fact that each cell is polarized, and the polarity at the single cell level leads to a collective motion. So polarity can be very important, and the fact that you have like polar objects which are in contact with each other can lead to a coordinated movement. That was the point that I wanted to mention through this study. Now, I said, okay, you can have polar object, but you can also get some nematic order if you think that even with polar object, if they are like if their polarity is not in the same direction, you may have something which is nematic when you can coarse grain the system. And so what is the nematic behavior? This nematic behavior can be defined if you have like particles, which are spindle-shaped particles, like microtubules, actin filament, or elongated cells. Okay, if you have cells which are elongated, then potentially, I mean, it's not for sure, but potentially you can define some kind of nematic order. So it's indeed the tendency to align together and to form this kind of like domain of alignment, even though you have domain of alignment over a given distance, but you usually have what people call the topological defect, so nematic defect that emerge in the system and that leads to the separation of this domain of cells which are aligned, or of microtubules, or I will give you a few examples. So the first picture I wanted to show you is this one from the, so it's before, on the left you have the cells, on the right you have this line convolution treatment, so you can observe that you have domains of alignment. So for instance here you can see that all those lines, they are like connect, they are like almost aligned in the same direction, and suddenly you have some singularities that in the system like this one, or you have another singularity that emerge in the system here, and this is what people call from the field of liquid crystal, people call the topological defect. So this is from a paper of Pascal Silberzan at the Institut Curie. And those topological defects can indeed be defined in this nematic system where you have you may have a nematic order, okay? So you have nematic order, so you have this, you can define a director which is the main orientation of this of those particles, okay? And the, as you can expect, the alignment of those particles is corresponds to the lowest energy state. But anyway, even in passive systems, so in liquid crystal, usually due to boundary conditions, or due to some defect that you have in the system during your preparation and so on, you may have some distortion in the field. So this distortion has been classified. Mostly, you may have a splay distortion if you think, so you have your nematic here, and you have, if you have these two glass slides which are forming an angle between each other, then usually those nematics, they could tend to align along the side of those glass plate, and they can form this kind of splay distortion, or they can even have another one which depends on the anchoring at the boundary. But you may have some bending also some bending distortion of the nematic director. So usually those kind of distortion in a passive system, they relax to the equilibrium if you have after some time, but that's something which is different in active nematics, and they can form based on this distortion. You may have some formation of singularities which are again this the fact that the orientation of the director field is discontinuous, and you can have you may have a different topological defect, and it depends on how the number that you have here is how you integrate the change in of direction of the nematic director when you make a 2π a turn over the center of the core of the defect. So usually in nematics, importantly, you can form these two defects, so the minus half and the plus half defect, so this kind of like trifold structure or the comet-like structure that you have here, okay? And of course, they can annihilate each other, okay? If they move toward each other, they will annihilate each other. And if you think of 2 plus half can form a plus 1, so if this plus 1, for instance, you can imagine that this plus 1 so usually there is a repulsion between 2 plus 1 plus half, but sometimes there is some recent paper published in Nature Physics showing that in active system, the activity of the system can even overcome this repulsion, so you may have even interaction between these 2 plus half. And if you have one plus half like that with a plus half which is again in the opposite direction here, let's say, and they meet each other, you will end up with this kind of structure which is a plus one. And for those of you who are interested in that, I mean, there are three papers which have been recently published in Nature Physics about topological defect in super different systems like bacteria, in the hydra as well, and they are really interesting. So I will give you a few examples as well. So these topological defects, they can be formed in, so here you can clearly see them in the same system than the one I was showing before, which is this microtubule system, okay? So you can see here clearly a plus half defect, and here a minus half defect, and they are observed in many biological systems. So you have here it's neural progenitor cells where you have again the formation of a plus half defect, a minus half defect. Another cell type, it has been observed in bacteria as well. and in different cellular system. And recently, that what I was mentioning, so this is bacteria, and what I was mentioning is this paper in Nature Physics, where it can even be important in the hydra during the morphogenesis. The hydra is an organism that can, when you cut one part, it can regenerate. So it's a super nice system. And here what you can see is the actin staining of the system. And you can see that you have a very long range nematic order in the hydra. And what these people observe is the fact that the mouth, the head, the foot, and even the tentacles, they are forming at specific topological defect. Okay, so I will let you read the paper if you are interested, but it's a very nice paper. Okay, so just to say that in this active systems, those topological defects, they can spontaneously emerge in the system due to the fact that the system is active and there is an active stress. And this active stress is coming from that part, the fact that you have, so if you look at the hydrodynamic equation of the nematic, so you have here you have the Navier-Stokes equation, and this Navier-Stokes equation, if you look at the force part, in the force part, you have like the gradient of the stresses plus friction forces, if you have friction forces, for instance, with the underlying substrate. Okay? And the stress is defined, of course, by the passive stress that I was talking about before, the fact that you have some passive rheology of the system, so you can define a viscosity of your system. You can define, of course, a pressure term that can be due to the elasticity of the system, but on top of it, so there are usually two terms, but I will not, I will, since we are talking about nematics, I will insist on the anisotropic part, sorry, of the active stress. And this active term is is proportional to the order parameter of alignment of the filament that you, or the filament or the cells that you have in the system. Okay? And here you have a constant in front of this order parameter, and I will so this term here can be either positive or can be negative. And I will come back to that. But the idea is that any distortion in the system, so this idea of having a bending effect, a slight bending suddenly, which is due to some fluctuation in the system or a splay distortion, will be amplified by the fact that you have activity, because this term here is the force here will be proportional to the gradient of the stress. So since the active stress is proportional to this order parameter, if you have this kind of gradient here, if you start to have a bend or some distortion, those distortions will be amplified by the activity. So the activity itself will provide new defect and will create the formation of new I mean distortion, will amplify the distortion in the system. So that's what you can clearly see from this part here, where you have this again, the active stress, which is defined by the proportionality with this order parameter and the activity coefficient. But here you can clearly see that you start with a bending, a little bit of bending of the microtubule filament, and after a while you have the system is splitting into two defects, a minus half here, a plus half here, and those two defects are moving away from each other, okay, and they form this kind of line of discontinuity between domains of alignment of the filament. So again, starting from a distortion, those distortions are amplified by the activity of the system. In that case, you have I mean an extensile system, meaning that you can see that the defect is moving to the left, which defines the sign of the active stress. So meaning that you have I will come back to this idea, but meaning that you have an extensile system. But anyway, the distortion will help to form this will help to increase again, the distortion will be amplified and amplified in such a way that you generate, and then you will annihilate as well, but you generate this, you create this topological defect spontaneously in this active system. Okay, so now in this kind of system, you may have different behavior. So that's another level of complexity. I was talking about a single cell. So in single cell, you have these force dipoles. That's why I was insisting on that at the beginning. And usually, you can clearly see here from this traction force map that you have two poles of forces at the end of the cell. Okay, and this cell is contractile, meaning that you will have forces which are directed inward. Okay, so here it's just the magnitude, so it's difficult to see, but you have forces which are pointing inward the cell. So you have this kind of contractile behavior at the single cell level, okay? And you may also have another behavior, which can be the fact that the system can be extensile, meaning that you can imagine that in some system you may have forces along the long axis here, like normal forces along the long axis that could be potentially larger than the forces along the short axis, perpendicular to the short axis, and so that will help the particles to elongate, and so you will have an extensile activity in that case. Okay, another way of seeing that is the fact that if you think of those bacteria here, those two bacteria, you have bacteria like Escherichia coli, for instance, that moves forward by like having this sorry. By having this kind of by bundling the flagellum at the end, so it will drive the flow along the bacteria like that, okay? But if you have a bacteria now which is a pusher, then the direction of the flow field will be completely different along the bacteria, okay? So based on that, it means that you may have a system that behaves differently. You have extensile versus contractile system in that case, depending on how. So here it's for the interaction of cells with the like mammalian cells and contraction on the substrate, but for the bacteria, it's clearly that the fact that you change the direction of the flow field around the bacteria. So single cells are contractile, and those defects, they can indeed, so you may have like arrangement of those particles, and you can imagine that depending on the force balance that you may have inside the system, based on what I was saying before, if the system is extensile, the direction of the defect, so here it's a plus half defect because the minus half, they have this trefoil shape, and usually they are not moving so much, so I will focus mostly on the plus half. For the plus half defects, they are moving forward, or they can move backward in a contractile system. So the signature of the motion of the defect will help you to define if the system is either extensile or contractile. All right. So now back to experiment. So what we are doing basically in the lab is this kind of experiment where we are looking at. I hope the movie is working. Bon, tant pis. I think the movie is not working. I don't know why. But anyway, we have here is like a disk of 1 millimeter, or we can even look at larger systems. But anyway, a disk of this size, and we look at the motion of cells. We can measure the force exerted by cells on substrate using this kind of experiment, which is important, which is an important advantage of in vitro experiments, is the fact that indeed you have a direct access of the forces or the stresses exerted by cells on the surface. And basically, what we did first is very simple: is we look at the orientation of cells to see if there is some alignment in the system or domains of alignment that will be a good indication that we can treat this system as a nematic system. Indeed, as you can see here, so we did some image treatment, and so the color code here is showing you the basically the orientation of the cells, and so the domain of alignment. So you have domains where cells are more or less aligned with each other, okay, among the system, and if you measure the elongation, they are indeed cells which are elongated. It's not a huge aspect ratio, but it's around like 1.8, okay, between the minor and the major axis. So it helps us to start to think that indeed those epithelial cells, we can treat them, and they could behave as a nematic tissue. In nematic tissue, what we know is that indeed, if you have some topological defect, so the next question is, in nematic, you may have topological defects, so it would be interesting to look at that, and it's known that this topological defect, there could be regions of high stress, And what we know from the biology or the mechanobiology field is the fact that when you have high stresses, usually it could be related to cell division, it could increase cell division, and it could have also an impact on cell extrusion potentially. So what we did is to look at those kind of movies, and what we observe indeed is that you have cells that can be in this kind of monolayer that can be extruded from the monolayer. Okay, so extruded meaning that you have cells that can be that are eliminated from the monolayer, and that's super important in biology because if you think of your intestinal epithelia, for instance, it's renewed every 4 or 5 days. So all the epithelial layer along your intestine is completely renewed every 5 days. So you have a lot of extrusion in the system, and that leads to this concept of the homeostatic pressure in the system, which is the fact that you have like cell division, which is balanced by the fact that you have cell extrusion in the system. So you have cell death or cell extrusion and cell division. So you increase the number of cells by division, you decrease the number of cells by eliminating them. What you can see here is that these cells, for instance, will be extruded in the third direction here in green. Okay, and you have this, the caspase here is an apoptotic marker, so it's a marker of the cell death. So it means that those cells is not only extruded from the tissue, but it's also dying as it is extruded. And what we observe along this, so here you have a cell, again in this movie, you have a cell which is extruded. Okay, so what we observe is that there is a flow field which was a bit strange all over the cell, so we started to think a little bit more about that. And what we found basically is the fact that if you look at the orientation of the cells and if you look at the site of extrusion, what we observed is that there was some kind of like spatial correlation between the formation of this comet-like structure. So you can see here that you start to have some kind of distortion, some kind of bending, and then some formation of comet-like structure, and the fact that cells can be extruded. So we tried to try to understand if there would be a correlation between the formation of those topological defects and the fact that cells can be extruded from an epithelial layer. So again, that's this idea that you may have like a homogeneous flow, smooth pattern, versus some kind of like bending activity or competing orientations of the cell, formation of those topological defects and cell extrusion. And that's exactly what we observe. Indeed, we look at the field of orientation, what we observe is that there is an extrusion here at the core of the topological defect. So to quantify that, what we did is to measure the different quantities, because we can do some PIV, we can do again force measurement. If you look at the velocity field around the plus half defect, what you observe indeed is that the defect is moving forward, meaning that the system is extensile. So that was the first surprise. It's the fact that what I was telling you is that at the single cell level, you have contractile activity, so you have a contractile system, but as a collective, the system is being as an extensile system. So I will come back to that if I have time, maybe not at the end of the talk. And what we observe also is so we did some simulation with a group of Julia Yeomans and with Amin Dust Mohammadi, who is now in Niels Bohr Institute in Denmark, and they used some continuum model for the simulation at this time. And what we observe is that we have at least some good correlation between these active pneumatic models and what we observe in this in the strain rate map of the around the topological defect. So basically what we did here is to average, it's not only one of course, is that we realign, since these defects have some kind of direction, because they have this comet-like structure, we realign all the defects along this direction, and we average that, and we measure the strain rate along those directions. Basically, what you expect also is that the activity, if you reduce the activity of the system, you may have less topological defect, because I was telling you that those distortions, they are amplified by the activity. So reducing the activity in the system is basically inhibiting the myosin. So when we inhibit the myosin 2 by using this bevacizumab treatment, we observe that there is a decrease of the number of defects, of the density of defects that we observe in the system, so which goes well with this idea that activity is very important for the generation of the topological defect. So I was saying that we quantify that. So we look at the correlation between the basically the distance between the extrusion site and the closest defect. And what we found indeed is that there was a nice correlation between the defect formation and the between the core of the defect and the extrusion site. Okay, and mostly at this plus half defect. Not really at a bit less at the minus half defect, and I will come back to this idea. Why is it more at the plus half than at the minus half? So for that, we did some traction force measurements. So I was saying before that that we can do these soft gels with beads inside, and you can measure the forces inside based on the displacement of the bead. So you can measure the force. And from the forces, you can infer. So we did some model with Vincent Nir and Philippe Marc at the Institut Curie to get the stress, because it's not trivial, because you have two measurements and you have three components of the stress, so you have one unknown. So we use this Bayesian method to measure the stress inside the tissue. And basically what we did here is to measure the pressure, if you want, or the isotropic stress inside the tissue. And what we observe is that, again, so we realign all the defects. What we observe is that at the plus half defect, we've got this stress map. So be careful, the blue means is negative and the red is positive. Okay, so which means that here you have a region which is under compression, and here you have a region which is under tension. Okay. Similarly, here, as you can expect, on the minus half defect, and that's why we think that there is less extrusion at the minus half defect, you have globally a system which is under tension. Okay, it's red all along the direction of the defect, so meaning that the system is under tension along those three lines, which is well correlated to what we observe with this simulation done by the group of Julia Yeomans. So again, that leads to this idea that you have high compressive stresses at this plus half defect. And if you think of a compressive stress, it can indeed lead to the fact that you may have cells that can be extruded in the soft direction, because you increase the compression. So we tested this idea by looking at the isotropic stress as a function of time, and what we observe is that indeed, of course, you have more topological defect than extrusion event, but when cells are extruded, what we observe is that there is an increase of the, so there is no threshold really, but there is an increase of the isotropic stress until the cell is extruded. So basically, our idea is that you have this comet-like structure which is pushing against the cell. At some point, at the core of the defect, you have a high compressive stress, and this is this compressive stress that leads to the movement of the cell in the soft direction and to the apoptotic behavior of this particular cell, which is located at the core of the defect. So the defect is generating the extrusion. Okay, so that was one part of the talk. And if do I have 5 minutes more, or is it over?
I think it's okay. You have 5 more minutes.
Okay, so I will just briefly introduce the concept of the next idea, and then I will stop. So I summarized that first story, and the second story, we were a bit puzzled by this idea that indeed single cell, they have as I was mentioning before, they have this contractile behavior. But again, if you look at those epithelial cells, they have some extensile behavior. And there were some other systems, as the system developed by Pascal Silberzan, where they use another cell line, which are fibroblasts. And we know that in fibroblast system, the contact between the cells are less strong than the one that we have in this epithelial cell. So meaning that those cell-cell junction, they are more labile and so on. So you form less cell-cell junction in fibroblast than in epithelial cell. So we saw that potentially the fact that you start to form strong contact between cells, strong adhesion, may be important in the fact that you switch from this contractile behavior as individual cells to something which is extensile as a collective for an epithelial layer. And so that's what we did by using some. So again, the system was extensile, and so that was the same idea. So what triggers the switch? And so we saw that indeed this idea of having contractile versus extensile system could be due to the fact that you have strong salsal junction in one case and not in the other case. And so again, so we generate a cell line which has no cadherin. So this protein that is making a strong contact and that is known to transmit the force from one cell to the other. So we've got this epithelial KO for icadherin. So this is a paper which is just online, which is online from last week. So you can have a look on that if you want more detail, because I will be quick on that story. But so what we did is to generate a cell line where basically we reduce a lot the adhesion between cells. Okay, and by doing so, we observe that indeed we can switch from an extensile to a contractile behavior just by knocking out this icadherin. So by changing the cell-cell contact, because we observe that the movement of the defect was indeed moving forward in the case of the wild type, as I was showing you before. But it was moving backward in the case of the same cell line, except that this icadherin was a knockout. Okay, so you can, so our idea is that you can indeed switch from this extensile to contractile behavior by changing the forces that you have at the intercellular stresses. So we did also some. So we checked, so you see that, for instance, if you look at, again, in the KO as the velocity field and in the wild type, you have opposite velocity field around the defect. One is moving upward, the other one is moving backward, similarly to what I was showing before. So we did some modeling as well with the group of, again, with Julia Yeomans and Amin. And in that case, we used some phase field model, so agent-based model and not discontinuum models. We use that because it's a nice way to indeed have, get a way to have independent active stresses internally and at the intercellular level. Okay, so we managed to like that to tune the stress at the intercellular level and that at the intracellular level. The intracellular level meaning basically the stress exerted by the cells through the cytoskeleton, and the intercellular level, meaning the stress exerted at the cell-cell junction, as you have from the as you can see here from those pictures. So we can tune that, and by tuning the stress by tuning the intercellular stress, which is indeed related to this idea that we can knock out the icadherin, so no force transmission at the cell-cell junction. Basically, we observed that the defect was in the simulation, the defect was also moving backward. So by changing the intercellular forces, you can switch from one behavior to the other. So I will not bother you with a lot of things, but it's clear that from the biology, you have a lot of mechanotransduction which is happening at this scale. If you change basically an important result is that if you change the cell-cell junction, so you have, again, you have the KO here where you reduce the interaction between cells, so the intercellular stress. As you do that, what you observe is that you have a signal which is this transcription factor which is named YAP, which is elevated because YAP is located, is localized in the nucleus in the case of the KO and not in the case of the wild type, meaning that you have cells which are probably exerting more interaction with the underlying substrate and which are transducing the force from the underlying substrate to the nucleus. And if we observe also focal adhesions, I mean how cells adhere, as you decrease the forces at the intercellular stress, as it is the case for the KO in comparison to the wild type, what we observe is that you increase the focal adhesion, so you increase the stress at the cell-substrate interface as you decrease the stress in the KO at the boundary between between cells. Okay, so really this is the idea that this crosstalk between cell-cell and cell-substrate adhesion can lead to this switch between extensile and contractile behavior. Okay, now I will stop here. If you want more details, you can have a look on the paper. I will just say that this is a mechanism. So what we did experimentally is we showed that this mechanism can be useful to understand cell sorting, okay, and how tissue can segregate, because when you have some mixed population, it turned out that the cells can indeed can fully segregate, and we think that I mean it could not be the only explanation, but we think that indeed this active part of the stress could be important to understand this tissue, the cell sorting, tissue segregation. And before, this kind of analysis was mostly done by, I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with that, with the Steinberg theory and so on, but by a purely physical system like surface tension, and the fact that if you have like different surface tension, then you can segregate the tissue. Here we think that maybe another hypothesis could be that the fact that indeed the activity based on this nematic activity can lead to cell sorting. Okay, so I will stop here. Sorry, I will conclude by saying that what we think is that this crosstalk between cell and cell substrate can indeed change the nematic behavior of epithelial cells, and the important result of that is that could be a way to interpret indeed the cell segregation. And with that, I just want to thank people who did this the part of the work. So for the rotation at the beginning, it was a super nice PhD student, Shri and Jane, who did this work, who is now a postdoc at the Institut Pasteur. For the part on cell extrusion, also a super good student from Singapore, Chuan Beng So. At the beginning with Leila Gogoslu, who is now an assistant professor in France. And for the last part about extensile contractile behavior, I would like to thank the Lakshmi, who is doing his PhD in the lab and who did a wonderful job in looking at those tissue behavior. And I would like to thank our collaborators, Alex Kabla for the rotation, Julia and Amin, I already mentioned them, Philippe Marc from the USPCI, and Alpha Yap, and Shefali Gupta from the University of Queensland. And I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Benoit.
Now I can drink a little bit of water.
Thanks a lot for the very visual and interesting talk. So I think that we already have something in the chat.
Do you want me to stop sharing or?
No, it is okay. It is okay.
It's okay. Okay.
So we have a question by Francesco Cavalleri. I can either read it out or maybe Francesco would like to formulate it himself.
Yes, sir. I can speak. Thank you for the talk. First, I want to observe and ask that these singularities recalls the fingerprints, and I'm wondering if the mechanism is the same, and if fingerprints can be described with these models.
I don't know if you saw that, but we wrote, I was mentioning this paper in Nature Physics, we wrote News and Views, and we use this fingerprint to highlight the fact that they form topological defect. Interestingly, just for the little history, but this the first, I think, who mentioned that was Penrose, but not the one who got the Nobel Prize, the father of Penrose, who published a paper in 1965 in Nature about these fingerprints and showing that indeed you have. I think, yeah, indeed, in fingerprints you have those kind of topological defect. Now, how they form and how you form those kind of ridges and so on, potentially there might be also some kind of instability and in the system that can lead to this to the formation of that. That's a good point, I think. But that's indeed the you have this singularity. Similarly, you have this plus one, you have minus half and plus half defect, yes, indeed, in the fingerprint. Now I don't know fully the biology of the skin, so I cannot tell you exactly how, I mean, especially at this scale, so I cannot tell you exactly how it can, I can imagine that once it's formed, then it stays there, but I think that could be related to this.
Thank you. Very interesting. And I have also a question I didn't understand in the first part
yeah.
If the single cell is can be both contracting or extensive, or the single cell is only contractive and a group of cell can be the opposite.
No, it's a single cell usually. I mean, maybe it's not true for all of them, but at least the one like fibroblast or epithelial cells, mostly if you look at those cells, they form this kind of they have elongated shape as a single cell, and they have this kind of force dipole along the long axis of the cell, so they are all contractile. Then there are some of course, I mean, in biology you have huge versatility, so you can find cells which have indeed different shape, like this, for instance. I was thinking of this fish keratocytes, for instance. They have a very different shape, and the forces can be different in that case. But in the cells, what I was talking about, this, for instance, and we check that these epithelial cells, they are contractile as a single cell, and they are extensile as a collective.
Thank you.
We have another question by Mauricio Moreira. Mauricio, would you like to turn your microphone on? Yes, I will read it out.
Hi. Thank you for this nicely done talk. Do you have a hypothesis for the reason why cells prefer to keep moving when they are over a substrate in vitro instead of keeping still?
Instead of not moving, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a good question. You mean for the rotation, for instance?
For any movement.
For any movement.
Yeah.
But I think one of the points is the I think one of the answer could be in this first in the fact that you have some activity. So if you have, I mean, that's what I was saying about this idea of distortion and the fact that in active system you amplify the distortion. I think it's at least one of examples that showing that activity can lead to some kind of like spontaneous movement, because in that case you will have for the formation of those defects that will move forward, and so that's could be due to the fact that you have some fluctuation in the system, some distortion, and those distortion can be amplified, and then we have then a flow of velocity. The other reason could be also that you in some of the system, that's why I was insisting on these polar particles, is the fact that you see in this kind of rotation, for instance, they are all polarized in the same direction, and this polarity is so I did not insist on that, but the polarity is also driven by the contact that cells are making with each other. So, and they are all polarized in the same direction. It's not like you have one cell which is polarized like that, the other one like that, and then they cancel each other. Then suddenly the fact that they start to have contact, they form some polarity which are all facing the same direction, and so that leads to this kind of to this rotation. Now, why they have all this polarity in the same direction, I don't know.
Thank you.
I have some hypotheses, but I don't have any clear response for them.
Juan, could you talk louder, please?
Nice talk.
Merci. Thank you.
To ask about the connection between the biomechanical components, like pressure or other that you mentioned, and the biochemical. For example, you talk about the field of orientation, and for example, in your equation, in one of the models you put in the slides, is a kind of Navier-Stokes equation where the biochemical, the proteins, are included in your model.
Basically, yeah, basically, it's some kind of, I mean, first, it's honestly, I mean, to be honest, it's not my model. I'm only doing experiments. So that's, but the, so this is a short answer. The long one is the fact that I'm this, the biochemical is included in this kind of coarse graining inside this active, inside the active stress. Indeed, we don't have the molecular details in this kind of model because it's completely coarse grain. I mean, you look at the system at long time scale where the system is usually viscous. That's why you have this kind of viscous stress at long time scale. And so I'm, in a sense, I'm just like averaging the molecular details, but I'm not entering into the detail of that. That would be interesting to indeed to, but that's what people are trying to do, to couple like reaction diffusion, for instance, plus this kind of active gel models, basically. But in this kind of active gels, you have some coarse graining indeed. So that's, you are not really looking at the problem of I mean, that's a very important question. But the problem of that is that usually you don't have so many details about the molecular processes. And so there are a lot of hypotheses that you have to make, which are usually, I mean, so either you coarse grain and you say, okay, that's the system globally is behaving like that. But you don't have, I think, so many. There are some systems like the one developed by, I think, but mostly at single cell level, the one developed by Perret. I was thinking of that because in Perret-Roca-Cusac, they have this clutch model that they use, and in their model, they have this, they have experiments indeed where they look also at single molecule stuff. So indeed, they are able a little bit in this model to couple the local the molecular properties plus the global behavior, but that's super difficult, I think, to have like a model where you are not like just making hypotheses on what it should be about actin polymerization, about the dynamics of adhesion, about everything, but that's an important point. Yeah.
Okay, I would like to ask something as well. You mentioned the fact that Hydra uses these topological defects to grow new organs on their sites, right?
I use the topological defect too.
The Hydra uses the sites of topological defects to grow new organs on those particular places. More broadly speaking, these topological defects, what other goals could they help to fulfill in, let's say, developmental processes?
But I think the goal, I don't know, because but I think it's just that they are region of high stresses. Mm-hmm. They are region of high stresses, and so if you have high stress at one region, then they can form a, that's what they observe. Basically, you can have like they can form a tentacle at some region. So you have usually what they form a tentacle, if I remember well, you form you have a plus you have a plus one defect at the tip of the tentacle and two minus plus one, sorry, at the top and two minus half at the bottom that cancel each other. But that's why you have you form this plus half potentially by interaction between these two plus half that will interact with each other, and then you may have like region of high stresses, and that could be some kind of mechanical control of the system. Then, of course, it's not only mechanical. I mean, I'm talking a lot about mechanics, but you have also some genetics. But basically, I think it's really related to this idea that this is creating region of high stresses mechanically.
So from there, you can create more complex structures.
Yeah, you can create more complex structure. You can move to the third direction. As you move for when you form a tentacle, you move to the third direction. And that's also what they observe. If you look at the other paper with the bacteria, they have bacteria that can peel up in the third direction due to the topological defect. So it's indeed a creation of like new structure, and potentially that could be important in morphogenesis.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense, indeed. Thank you, Benoit. So anybody else would like to ask something? If this is not the case, maybe we can conclude the session here.
Okay.
Thank you, Benoit, again.
Thank you so much again for the invitation, and I hope that we will meet next time.
In a more usual way, yes.
Okay, take care in the meantime, and thanks for organizing those meetings.
Well, thank you, and thanks everybody for attending. Just let me announce that next week we will have a seminar by Tom Hillen about metastasis, mathematical modeling of metastasis. We will send the advertisement next week, and hope to see you there. Take care.
Ciao, guys.